family, friends, and can we have people start taking their seats, please? Family, friends, and guests, could you please begin taking your seats, moving toward a seat, please? Ladies and gentlemen, if you'll please take your seats, the program will now begin. Ladies and gentlemen, if you'll please take your seats, the program will begin very shortly. All rise. The United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit is now in special session. Would you please be seated? You can tell that this is a special session because no one is wearing robes. I would like to list and read those members of the Ninth Circuit, many of whom are here, a majority of whom are here, to witness this occasion. We have with us today the Honorable Mary Murguia, the Honorable Clifford Wallace, the Honorable Mary Schroeder, the Honorable William Canby, the Honorable Dermud Scanlon, the Honorable Michael Hawkins, the Honorable Sidney Thomas, the Honorable Margaret McEwen, the Honorable Kim Wardlaw, the Honorable Marsha Berzon, the Honorable Johnny Rawlinson, the Honorable Richard Clifton, the Honorable Consuelo Callahan, the Honorable Morgan Christen, the Honorable Paul Watford, the Honorable Andrew Hurwitz, the Honorable Michelle Friedland, the Honorable Ryan Nelson, the Honorable Eric Miller, the Honorable Bridget Beatty, the Honorable Danielle Forrest, and the Honorable Patrick Bumate. We will begin today's program by having the Girl Scout Troop 1688 from West Phoenix present the colors. After the colors are presented, we will be led in the Pledge of Allegiance, and we will then have the national anthem sung by Constance Genter. Would you please all stand for the presentation of the colors? Would you please join me in repeating the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, and justice for all. Constance Genter.
By the dawn's early
Please be seated. As you may imagine, we have, well, thank you to the Girl Scout Troop 1688 of West Phoenix. And to Constance Genter. As you may well imagine, we have a number of dignitaries in the audience today, apart from those members of the Ninth Circuit who are here. We have virtually all of the district, magistrate, and bankruptcy judges for the District of Arizona, as well as the United States Marshal, the United States Attorney, the United States Federal Public Defender, and the court unit executives of the District Court of the District of Arizona. Would you all please stand? That's enough. Thanks, we don't want it to go to our heads. We have, representing the legislative branch of government, the Honorable Luis Heredia on behalf of Senator Mark Kelly's office. And we have as well, that's who we have. So, thank you. In addition, we in Arizona are blessed to have a very excellent state judiciary, which is represented here today by Chief Justice Robert Brutinel, retired Chief Justice Scott Bales, and Justice William Montgomery from the Arizona Court of Appeals, or from the Arizona Supreme Court. From the Arizona Court of Appeals, we have the Honorable Mary Elena Cruz, and from the Maricopa County Superior Court, we have Judge Joe Welty, and former presiding judge Barbara Mandel. We have a large number of Phoenix Municipal Court judges here today. We have also visiting out-of-circuit judges and district judges from all over the Ninth Circuit and other places who are personal friends of Judge Murguia. They include the Honorable Ann Montgomery, the Honorable Sharon Gleason, the Honorable Anna Brown, the Honorable Beverly Martin, the Honorable Claudia Wilkin, the Honorable Marcia Beckman, the Honorable Karen Schreier, and the Honorable Fernando Olguin. In an audience like this, virtually everybody else is a person of importance and significance, but we're not going to recognize you, other than to say we recognize you're all people of importance and significance, and you are very welcome here. We are very honored today to have our first speaker be the Honorable Mary Schroeder, Senior Circuit Judge, who herself has served as the Chief Judge of the Ninth Circuit. She will be followed by the Honorable Michael Daly Hawkins, a Senior Circuit Judge of long service here in Phoenix, and the Honorable Margaret McEwen, who has been especially noted for her work in judicial ethics and workplace relations. Judge Schroeder.
Thank you, Chief Judge Snow. It is just wonderful to have all of you here. It's a great day for Phoenix, and it's great to see so many people in the atrium of our courthouse. I am very pleased to have been asked to say a few words this afternoon. I have had the honor of serving as Chief Judge of this circuit, and I have known and admired our new Chief Judge for many years. We refer to each other as Mary Senior and Mary Junior, and I don't have to tell you which is which. I thought I would first take a few minutes to reflect on the history of the Office of Chief Judge, and then provide the answers to questions some of you might have about Mary Junior, who is now Chief Judge Murguia. That sounds great. The Ninth Circuit is the largest, and we all think the greatest, of the 11 geographic circuits. We are proud of the fact that we are the only federal Pacific jurisdiction and that we span about one-sixth of the globe. The chief is the chief of the entire circuit, including the Court of Appeals, district, and bankruptcy courts in 9 states. The Ninth has a proud history of quality judicial administration led by some remarkable chief judges. I want to give you only a small sample of the legacy that Judge Murguia inherits. The first great chief of modern times was Richard Chambers of Arizona. who by something of a fluke was appointed to the circuit as a Tucson Republican when, as he used to put it, Tucson Republicans met in a phone booth. He served as chief judge for 17 years and will be long remembered for the historic buildings up and down the circuit that he fought to preserve, including courthouses in San Diego, Pasadena, San Francisco, Portland, and Seattle. Our Ninth Circuit Courthouse in Pasadena is named for him and contains a portrait that I assure you looks nothing like him. Judge Chambers was followed by James R. Browning of Belt, Montana, the last chief judge to serve before chiefs were limited to 7 years, and for whom the San Francisco Courthouse is named. In his 12 years of service, he was an innovator, introducing the Bankruptcy Appellate Panel, affectionately known as the BAP, and made administration of a large federal court possible by introducing the limited en banc, i.e., an en banc court consisting of fewer than all the active judges, and by expanding participation of district judges, magistrate judges, and bankruptcy judges on all governing bodies and committees of the circuit. This took imagination, legislation, and patience. Browning was followed by Ted Goodwin of Oregon, whose great achievement was guiding the circuit through the San Francisco Loma Prieta earthquake of 1989. We never lost a sitting, and the folks in the clerk's office would have to go to the basement of the courthouse with flashlights to get the briefs and records to send to the judges. Cliff Wallace, who is with us this afternoon, was chief during what some of us jokingly called the Babylonian captivity, where we held court after the earthquake in an upscale shopping center near the Embarcadero in San Francisco with lovely offices designed by Betty Fletcher. It was hard getting everyone back to 7th and Mission, but Cliff and Proctor Hugg, who succeeded Cliff as chief, saw to it that our judges went back and that the circuit stayed united. Proc was a planner and put together programs that focused on issues of administration that had not been addressed, including public relations and mental health. Throughout the tenure of all these predecessors of Sid Thomas, the Ninth Circuit became known as innovative, well-administered, but, well, different. With Sid's tenure, the circuit stepped into real national leadership in areas like technology, security, and budget cut survival. The transition to Judge Murguia should be seamless because Sid made sure Judge Murguia was involved in everything, which is why I have almost never seen her in Phoenix in the last 7 years. As for Judge Murguia, I would like to try to make the transition even easier for her. So I'm briefly letting you all in on 5 things you should know about her. Number one, when is it not safe to disturb Judge Murguia? Answer, her loyalty to her judicial chiefdom may be secondary to her loyalty to the Kansas City Chiefs. So never call her during a Chiefs game. Two, what should you do if you confuse her with her identical twin sister, Janet? Answer, do not get upset. Everyone does it. Three, does she ever get angry? Answer, not very often, but be careful. Four, does she always look this good? Answer, yes. Five, are there government officials more dedicated to serving the public than Chief Judge Mary Murguia? Answer, absolutely not. So in conclusion, I can only say to my good friend Mary Jr., go Chief.
Well, we're witnessing here a transition, and I'll share a story with you about a transition that occurred in Washington decades ago. It turned out that the incoming secretary for this department and the outgoing secretary met in the hallway of the building, and the outgoing secretary wished good luck and said, oh, by the way, I've left three envelopes on the back of your desk. And when a crisis occurs, open the first envelope. The new secretary forgets about this until the crisis occurs, and then he remembers about the envelopes. And he opens the first envelope, and it says, blame it on your predecessor. It works. The press goes after the former secretary. The new person is able to go about their business relatively unfettered. Months later, another crisis occurs. This time, the new secretary remembers the envelopes right away. Opens the second envelope, and the second envelope says, blame it on Congress. It works. They leave the secretary alone. They go chasing after the committee chairs, asking why they didn't do what they were supposed to do. And then a third crisis comes along, and this one seems impossible to lay off on other people. But he remembers the envelopes, and he opens the third one, unfolds it, and it says, write three envelopes. Something like that occurred in the Ninth Circuit when Sid Thomas became our chief judge 7 years ago. Only his envelopes didn't have suggestions. They contained a series of very serious crises. So his first envelope was, deal with a workplace environment crisis in the wake of the resignation of your predecessor. And he did. He got good people to work on the problem, reestablish lines of communication, and I think everyone feels more comfortable about the situation now. Then came the second envelope. It said, you have 10 new judges, almost a third of your court's complement, some of whom may have a little different idea on how to run this court. Sid stood up to that. The new judges were welcomed. Their space needs were taken care of, and we moved on. Then the third envelope, it said, you'll have to deal with a worldwide epidemic that will change in every conceivable way the way you do business. So we had to gear up, rely on our technological people, arrange for arguments completely remotely, which we're just now starting to wean out of. The ancient Chinese warrior philosopher Lao Tzu said, the way you tell someone is a really good leader is when the job is done, the task is accomplished, the people say, we did this ourselves. Well, we on this court know we did not do this ourselves. We had scores of law clerks, administrators, computer wizards, and hardworking colleagues to help us through the crisis. But all of us know that it was done under the competent, thoughtful, decent leadership of Montana's favorite son, Sidney Runyon Thomas.
Good afternoon. It's a great honor to be here at this wonderful ceremony. I do first want to acknowledge Chief Judge Thomas and his remarkable contributions to the circuit. We first bonded over our home states. I'm from Wyoming. Oops. He's from Montana. But people often say, oh, you're from Montana. And with incredulity, I say, no, I'm from Wyoming. And then they tell Chief Judge Thomas how proud he must be to be from Wyoming. And looking bemused, he says, no, Montana. And so it's been going now for many years, Montana, Wyoming, Montana, Wyoming, Wyoming, Montana, and it will continue. As you know, he has overcome government shutdowns, tsunamis, earthquakes, fires, sequestration, and more. But in all of this, I have found only one fault. And despite his near perfection and everything else, for inexplicable reasons, he loves word perfect. So now we move to the peaceful transition of power, and I'm honored to say a few words about my friend and colleague, the country's first Latina Chief Circuit Judge, Chief Judge Mary Murguia. To be first among equals, especially her colleagues, is a hat trick, but Judge Murguia is up to the task. Now to begin, she brings the gift of friendship and a sense of humor, and believe me, as Chief Judge of the Ninth Circuit, she will need both of those. Whenever you call her, her first response is, "Hey, how's it going? What's up?" You've all heard that. But it's not really a reflexive question. She genuinely cares about people, and important to this task ahead, she listens. She's constantly asking everyone and others, what do they think? And that kindness and caring has translated into remarkable friendships like those with all of you here, from her childhood, from her time in the U.S. Attorney's Office, her time on the district court, and of course, now her time with her colleagues on the Ninth Circuit. As a circuit judge, she gets plenty of travel, but being an overachiever, she has asked for more travel and more adventures. Picture this: raft trip down the Green River or the Grand Canyon, hiking, trips to Vermont and New York City. And I have it on good authority that at one point, she actually appeared in Times Square singing Man of La Mancha. Now the good news is that she could appear quite serious, but she likes to have fun and she has a great sense of humor. We all know, of course, she's a rabid KU, University of Kansas fan, and a sports fanatic. So do not get in her way where there is a game, because she will stop at nothing to find a viewing location. Of course, her loyalty to all this started years ago when she and her sister, twin Janet, first arrived at KU. They were shown their dorm room, and they asked with all sincerity, how many other people will be sleeping here? So after a very tight-knit, close quarters with her family, she graduated to a spacious dorm room, and then after that to some pretty elegant hotels. So it's ironic that now she's actually consented to go camping and sleep on the ground and pay for that experience. And I assure you, when she walks out of that tent, it is no surprise that she looks like $1 million. She is not an ordinary disheveled camper. The second thing I want to highlight is that Judge Murguia brings long-standing professionalism and a commitment to ethics. She's had a perfect training for overseeing a circuit with 6,000 staff members, 15 districts, and 418 judges. She held the prestigious position of director of the Executive Office of United States Attorneys under Attorney General Janet Reno. And there she had oversight over approximately 5,000 U.S. attorneys and 5,000 DOJ staff. And her successful career as a prosecutor handling some of the toughest cases called on her to exercise judgment and legal expertise. Now, fortunate for all of us, she's also worked at the national level of the judiciary and served for 4 years on the Codes of Conduct Committee. That's the Ethics Committee for federal judges. And in that role, she was called on constantly to dispense ethics advice to federal judges around the country. Her sensitivity to ethics is longstanding, and I think it's underscored by one of her high-profile cases here in Arizona involving Mr. Arpaio while she was on the district court. He filed a motion to disqualify her because of alleged bias, but notably she wrote the following: "The idea that a Hispanic judge should never preside over a controversial case concerning alleged acts of profiling purportedly committed against Hispanics is repugnant to the notion that all parties are equal before the law, regardless of race. And though she actually rejected those claims of animus and bias, she said in an abundance of caution she would step away from the case. So her decision to take the high road is a mark of her character and her integrity. And finally, to our courts in the Ninth Circuit, she brings a sense of fairness, humility, and justice. We often refer to the court family because we are like a family. And on this score, Judge Murguia has plenty of experience. She comes from a very large family, as you know, and she knows how to navigate the ups and downs, eccentricities, and love of a very big and diverse family. Her upbringing by two dedicated parents has shaped who she is: humble, giving, and dedicated to justice. She remembers her parents often saying, "Aquí, en ese país, el sol brilla para todos." That is, here, in this country, the sun shines for all. Her family represents what we take pride in celebrating our country as a land of opportunity. And Judge Murguia took that opportunity and she ran with it. She understands that justice is not an abstract system of precedent, but a means of resolving disputes about people, their lives, and their complications. And on that score, life experience matters, and she brings more than her share for all of us. Judge Murguia has made her mark with her family, her friends, her community, her profession, and her colleagues. She is poised now to make her mark as the first person of color to serve as the Chief Judge of the Ninth Circuit. So, Mary, I know it'll be a wild ride, I'm sure, but we all want to be part of your magic carpet. Congratulations on this very special day.
We will now be pleased to hear from Casey Arellano, who is the president of the local Phoenix chapter of Los Abogados. And she will be followed by Janet Murguia, who, as you have heard, is Chief Judge Mary Murguia's twin sister, but is also the president and CEO of Unidos United States. Ms. Arellano.
Thank you. Judge Thomas, Judge Murguia, Chief Snow, members of the judiciary and attendees. Bienvenidos y buenas tardes. My name is Casey Arellano, and I'm a trial attorney at the EEOC and the president of Los Abogados Hispanic Bar Association. About 10 and a half years ago, I had the privilege of being an extern for Judge Murguia the summer she transitioned from the district court to the Court of Appeals. And she has been an important mentor and role model in my life ever since. As I was preparing for today, I did some online research, and I discovered that all of today's speakers have their own Wikipedia pages. I barely have a functioning LinkedIn page, so I'm truly humbled and honored to be speaking today. In 2000, Judge Murguia became the first Latina to serve on the United States District Court for the District of Arizona. And today, we are here to celebrate another historic moment as she will serve as the first Chief Judge of the United States Courts of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit and the first Latina and woman of color to lead a United States circuit in this country. What a monumental occasion. Representation in the judiciary is critical. Our justice system can only be better if it reflects the population it serves. And here in the Ninth Circuit, where we have a strong and vibrant Latino population, representation Latino representation in the legal profession is especially important. There is no question Judge Murguia will serve the community well. Judge Murguia has dedicated her career to public service, to her country, to the courts, to the community. And there is no doubt that she is exceptionally qualified to serve as Chief Judge. And I'd like to take a moment to talk to you about who she is outside the courtroom as well. One of the many reasons Judge Murguia is so extraordinary is because she builds community wherever she goes. Years ago, she began a book club for Latina lawyers. She had a vision to create a space where Latinas could come together to find a sense of community and shared purpose. From that vision, she sparked a robust mentoring program that brings together Latinas from all backgrounds called the Latina Mentoring Project. Through the groundwork she laid, generations of Latinas have come together to support and uplift each other. She's also championed Courtworks, a program designed to bring 7th and 8th grade students to the judiciary and teach them about a career in law. Sometimes they do this through a spirited mock trial. She brings together volunteer lawyers and attorneys, but for many of the students who participate in Courtworks, they never previously dreamed of setting foot inside the federal courthouse. And when they see Judge Murguia in her role, it tells them, if she can do it, maybe I can too. Even today, Judge Murguia chose to have a local Girl Scout troop complete the colors of the guard instead of a military color guard. In every space and at every opportunity, she shows us that we matter. Challenges for Latinos in the legal profession are many. From being first-generation Americans to language barriers, the rising costs of law school, and even as lawyers and judges, the pressure to work hard and be better, the road can be long and tough. During my first year in law school at the George Washington University Law School, I spent the entire year waiting for someone from admissions to come tell me they'd made a mistake and I needed to unenroll. And as I began my practice as a lawyer and through my service in Los Abogados, working with countless law students, aspiring law students, and lawyers of all practice areas, I began to realize that this feeling that we as Latinos don't belong or can't succeed was all too common in nuestra comunidad. Judge Murguia's service as Chief Judge of the United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit is a powerful reminder for when we hear those voices telling us that we can't, we shouldn't, or we won't. It is a reminder that we can, we should, and we will. Podemos, debemos, y haremos. It is a reminder for those of us who identify as diverse that not only do we have a seat at the table, but we can be leaders as well. Judge Murguia has always been a trailblazer, and her new position only confirms that she will continue to hold the torch for those of us to follow. From the District Court to the Court of Appeals to now in her role as Chief Judge, at every step of the way, she pushed the envelope and broke barriers so we didn't have to. When she rises, we all rise. To Judge Murguia, on a personal note, I want to thank you for showing me that anything is possible. And on behalf of all of the Latinos and diverse individuals who are here today, but more importantly, on behalf of those who are not here, on behalf of those who dream of going to law school, who are in law school, and the young lawyers, thank you. Thank you for your generosity, your courage, your dedication, your hard work, your excellence, and the legacy you have created for us all. Judge Murguia, we are so proud of all you have done and will continue to do. Con gracias y adelante.
Good afternoon. My name is Janet Murguia, and as Judge Snow just said, I am the president and CEO of Unidos US, formerly the National Council of La Raza and the largest Latino civil rights and advocacy organization in the United States. But as has been referenced, if you look closely, you'll also see that I bear some resemblance to our honoree today. Mary and I, or I mean Judge Murguia, as she prefers that I call her, she and I go way back. Since we are twins, you could say that we started as womb mates. Now, my memory doesn't quite go back that far, but I'm pretty sure even then, Mary was making decisions and issuing orders, because I'm not entirely certain it was fate that dictated my coming out into the world first. I kind of think Mary wanted that womb all to herself for at least a full 6 minutes. Seriously, I have had the incredible privilege of being on a life journey with Mary since we were born. And as I have sat and listened to the wonderful remarks thus far, I can affirm so much of what has been said. Mary is very smart and knowledgeable. She's hardworking, experienced, knows the law, is a strong leader, has excellent judicial temperament, and acts with the highest standards of integrity. She has been an outstanding lawyer, prosecutor, judge, and colleague. But what I can attest to as well is that beyond her intellect and commitment to the law, Mary has a beautiful heart. And I just want to take a couple of minutes to share with you a little bit about the Mary that you may not see every day in the courtroom. She has been a devoted daughter, a loving sister, a caring aunt, an exemplary mentor, and an exceptional friend. Mary is kind, thoughtful, generous, and loyal. And she exhibits these attributes when no one is looking. She is a reflection of the values instilled in her by our parents, including a strong sense of faith, family, humility, and the importance of being in service to others. Many of the people here today do know Mary in that capacity. It is a tribute to her values that she is supported by a loving family and a large cohort of friends, not just today, and they're all here, but every day and throughout her entire life. Mary has always made time for family. And even though you've heard some of the judges talk about Mary's caseloads and traveling and always having a number of responsibilities, she has put her family first. Whether it's been with my mother's long battle with Alzheimer's, helping my sister Rosemary, who battled breast cancer and is now a survivor, another sister dealing with illness with special needs, Mary's been there, not just as a health advocate, but to encourage, to support, to be present, and just to hold their hands during their scariest moments. My nieces and nephews have benefited from a very engaged aunt who remembers birthdays, graduations, attends weddings, of course, and is always trying to be there, and they turn to her for counsel, advice, and support, and she's there. Mary also joins in on our family gatherings and plans and organizes cooking the turkey and helping make sure that everybody has duties as assigned to bring these family events together. I do the gravy. But Mary even took time and has taken time in the past to organize family talent shows. We apply that term loosely, and has even participated with different innovative ways. You can ask her about her talents later. And when it comes to friends, I'm reminded of a saying they had back in Washington. If you want a friend, get a dog. Wait, no, that's not the right saying for this occasion. There is another saying: to have a friend, you have to be a friend. Mary knows how to be a friend. She is still in touch with friends from grade school, including kindergarten, and in the audience today are friends from junior high school, college, law school, of course from her time in the DA's office back in Kansas, from her time as assistant U.S. attorney in Arizona and on the federal bench. Her clerks are family to her, and she keeps up with all of them professionally and personally and their growing families. She still takes time to check in and organize gatherings of our friends and is happiest when different groups of them convene or come together for various occasions. She loves bringing people together. This is an amazing day. As the head of a Latino civil rights organization, I'm proud that we are making history today. As Judge Schroeder referenced, Mary is making history. She is the first Hispanic and Latina to serve as Chief Judge of the U.S. Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals and the first Latina to be Chief at the Circuit Court of Appeals level. That's big. And while Mary has blazed this trail, I admire so much how she has taken the time to encourage, advise, and mentor many young lawyers on their careers, as we heard. You know, it was hard not to look at that Girl Scout troop and be reminded of the power of the American dream today, because that any one of those little girls could have been a young Mary Murguia back in Kansas City, Kansas, in our Latino neighborhood, dreaming one day about what we could achieve, what she could achieve. And today we're seeing a dream realized. I sure wish my parents could be here today. But I know they're in heaven looking down, bursting with pride and smiling and sending down blessings. And of course, they're here in spirit. And as proud as they must be of this incredible career accomplishment and milestone for their beloved youngest daughter, I believe they are happiest knowing she has lived the values they instilled in her, and they are most proud of the person Mary has turned out to be. I know I certainly am. Mayor, one thing that I can say here today, and that I know no higher court can overrule me, all respect to the judges here, you are the best womb mate ever. I love you. Congratulations, Judge Murguia.
Not very long ago, I had occasion to call Libby Smith, who was then the Ninth Circuit executive, because in the state of Arizona, District of Arizona, a funding formula was about to be implemented that would have a very negative effect on our ability to operate. She said, "Let me get in touch with Chief Judge Thomas," and she did. He called me, immediately planned out a strategy to help us, and said, "You'll also want to get in touch with Judge Callahan, because she served on the relevant committee," and he arranged a conference call with Judge Callahan. Judge Callahan provided very good advice and helped us throughout that process, as did Chief Judge Thomas. But those of you who know Judge Callahan know that one of her very enduring traits is she is quite direct. And at the end of one of our calls, she asked me, Don't you know how busy Chief Judge Thomas is? And the truth is, no, I didn't know how busy Chief Judge Thomas was. I had an idea, but I also have an idea that none of you know how busy Chief Judge Thomas was. Because one of the things I'm not sure that Judge Callahan knew was, this was not the first time Chief Judge Thomas had volunteered to intervene to help the District of Arizona when it was in dire need. As I began my chief judgeship, we had several long-standing vacancies. Chief Judge Thomas always, always advocated their filling and always called me. I never had to call him to let me know what the status was. When Arizona was certified as an opt-in state for habeas corpus proceedings, and if you're not a judge, you can't have any idea what the possible negative or demanding ramifications of that was, I did not first call Chief Judge Thomas. Chief Judge Thomas first called me to see what he and the Ninth Circuit could do to help us in the event that that opt-in status remained in place. He has, as far as the District of Arizona goes, revised portions of the Ninth Circuit leadership structure to incorporate and accommodate the needs of Native Americans, a unique justice need in the federal court which has been underserved for many, many years. And even these last few days of his service as chief judge, he has been advocating for our district and seeking a carve-out from an executive order that would and will have a devastating effect on Southwest border courts if it is not implemented. And I know he has spent a great deal of time advocating for rational change. So, Judge Callahan, I don't have any idea how busy Chief Judge Thomas was, but I do know that he's gracious, that he's unassuming, that he's a hardworking friend of this district. He's not only a hardworking friend of the Ninth Circuit and the federal judiciary, but of every district and bankruptcy court that makes it up. I am certain that I represent both the District of Arizona and every other chief judge of every other district and bankruptcy court in this circuit in thanking him for his service. I am sure that today he is the happiest person in this building with the possible exception of his spouse, Martha, and we are now grateful to hear from him.
Well, thanks to Chief Judge Snow. It has been wonderful to work with the District of Arizona. The district has had many, many challenges, even more than the ones that you've listed. And we've gone back many years with your predecessors. And one of the great things about Judge Murguia coming on as chief is that you will have somebody right in this building you can go right down and talk to get things done. And I know she will be a tremendous advocate for the District of Arizona. And before I have the privilege of passing the gavel, I wanted to express some words of thanks. We've had a lot of challenges the last 7 years, and we didn't get through them just because of me. We got through them because of collective efforts of this circuit. And I could not be more proud to serve with the judges of the circuit, the district, circuit, bankruptcy judges, and all the staff, because you have been absolutely wonderful. And by getting together and working through these problems collectively, we solve them. And in fact, I think we are stronger for them. It has been my great honor and privilege to serve with you. And thank you, every one of you, very much. Now, Judge Murguia and I share some things in common, including the fact that our fathers were born in Oklahoma. 10th Circuit, I know, but, you know. But as her sister Janet said, we share a fierce love of family. And my family is here today. My wife, Martha, came down with our two sons. And my sister, Karen, who got her doctorate at Arizona State University in choral music, is here. She lives in Prescott Valley. And my sister, Susie, is watching, the Reverend Susan Thomas. And I could not have done anything without all of you. We've been fortunate to have many children on the court, but I'm the only judge so far whose all of his sons were born after I took the oath. And the burden fell on my family with the travel, especially on Martha in the early years and continuing. She practices a full-time attorney. And I just have to say thank you so much for sticking with me, because I could not have done this without you. So now it's time to pass the gavel to my dear friend, Mary Murguia, who will do, as you've heard, a marvelous job as chief judge. And here's the gavel. It's inscribed from me to you, but it also contains the expression to which Judge McEwen alluded, the English translation of which is, "Here in this country, the light shines, the sun shines on all." Thank you.
Many of you, particularly those of you who are Ninth Circuit judges, may wonder what a district court judge is doing conducting a Ninth Circuit service. I have to admit, I wondered the very same thing and suggested to Judge Murguia when she asked me to do it that it was inappropriate. She told me that she wanted me to conduct because she wanted to recognize the court that she came from. And since I represented that court, she wanted me to be here conducting. And of course, that love is returned by the fact that virtually all of our judges are here to see this event. But I must tell you that when I first became a district court judge, one of the things I was delighted to see was a naturalization ceremony. So I asked my family to come down and watch one, and they came and watched one at which Judge Murguia presided. Judge Murguia, I'm sorry, she is wasted at the Ninth Circuit, because nobody can do a job like she did in those naturalization ceremonies. She connected so intimately and so quickly with those that were becoming new citizens that they immediately loved her. And not only that, but as they saw her from the bench and as she shared some of the stories that were alluded to earlier by Judge McEwen, they realized that in fact, in this country, the sun does shine on everyone, because there before them was a very kind, gracious, and caring embodiment of the American dream. My family, although that event is now 12 years ago, has never forgotten it, and they talk about it all the time. I have encouraged Judge Murguia to come back and do a naturalization ceremony from time to time. So far as I'm aware, she hasn't accepted that offer. But I promise you I will continue to repeat it. And if any of your colleagues from the Ninth Circuit are there, I would invite you. You will be benefited. Judge Murguia keeps long hours. We accuse her in this courthouse of keeping Dracula hours. She is hardworking, considerate, gracious. She sweats the details. The statute that designates who will be the chief judge doesn't necessarily distinguish between who will be a good chief judge and who will not. But in this instance, it has operated to transfer that position from one excellent chief judge to another. Isn't the Ninth Circuit most fortunate? We will now be very pleased to hear from our new chief judge, Mary Murguia.
Thank you so much, Chief Judge Snow and Judge Thomas, and everyone here today and watching via live stream. I am deeply honored and humbled to accept this gavel with this enormous responsibility. Judge Thomas, as we've heard earlier and have witnessed for the last 7 years, you have been outstanding in leading the circuit through these uniquely challenging times. You have provided decisive and reassuring leadership throughout your tenure as chief. Thank you for your invaluable contributions to our circuit and to our country, and for the values and ideals of justice and equality that you embrace and display both on and off the court every day. To be sure, Montana can stand proud. I can only hope during my tenure as chief to be able to emulate a fraction of your steadfastness, clarity, and grace. And thank you, Judges Schroeder, Hawkins, and McEwen, for your marks here today, for your invaluable support, wise counsel, and mentorship. Judge Schroeder, as she referred to, and for many years now, in our correspondence to each other, you are Mary the senior, and I am Mary the junior. And many of you know, Judge Schroeder was our first circuit's female chief judge, our circuit's first female chief judge, and until now, our only female chief. And when Judge Schroeder was chief, she traveled all the time and everywhere within the circuit. She has imparted her wisdom, her love of the West, and her love of the circuit to me. And for that and many other things, I am most grateful. To be a woman chief judge on the circuit, I suppose it's not required to be named Mary and to be based in Arizona, but as it turns out, it doesn't hurt. Judge Hawkins, I have known and admired you since I first came to Arizona more than 30 years ago to work for the U.S. Attorney's Office. You were an early and critical supporter of mine, and I deeply appreciate that. Thank you for your support back then, today, and throughout our many years of working together on the court. Judge McEwen, you are a force. You took me under your wing when I first came to the court. And for those of you who do not know Judge McEwen, when she takes you under her wing, you had better hold on. So that's what I've tried to do. Judge McEwen, you are a thoughtful and considered jurist with a passionate dedication to the circuit and the people we serve. You have done so much as an educator, a prolific author, a civic leader. I deeply value your advice and insights, but you have also been a true friend, and I'm most grateful for that. Chief Judge Snow, thank you for agreeing to lead this ceremony today and for your exemplary leadership of the District Court of Arizona. I did want to have this ceremony here. It's quite meaningful for me today to have this ceremony where I first became a judge and in front of so many dear friends who supported me as a district court judge. But we have all greatly benefited from your leadership, Judge Snow. Casey, I appreciate your kind words. You are an outstanding legal expert, and you now represent the Latino community and the broader legal community in such an excellent manner. And to my sister, Janet, I am so grateful to you for a lifetime of support
and for your unwavering faith in me. Everyone here may not know this, and her remarks were very generous, but Janet and I have been very competitive our whole lives. We are identical twins, and sometimes identical twins will switch places, I've heard. We may or may not have had a little fun in that regard, but we never switch classes in school. The reason for this really comes back to our competitiveness. She didn't want me taking her tests, and I didn't want her taking mine. I thought I could do better than she could. She thought she could do better than me. Each of us thought we could outdo the other. I think this strong sense of competition and our mutual respect for each other, which there is a deep mutual respect for each other, has brought out the best in both of us and has propelled us professionally throughout our lives. Through her leadership and hard work as a civil rights leader, she has affected so many lives for the better. So Jay, I know we have a history of being competitive, but you could not possibly be more proud of me than I am of you. When I first became a judge over 20 years ago, I was of course impressed by the high level of intellectual discourse, first on the district court and then on the circuit court. I expected that and continue to be impressed by it. But what also inspired me and inspires me still was the collegiality among the judges throughout our circuit, and the sense of community that we together have created. The deep friendships I have made, a number of my colleagues who have become dear friends are here today or are watching through live stream, and I'm very grateful to each of you. I know I'm repeating what other judges in the circuit have said before about being and feeling a part of a larger community, but I do so because it's true. And despite our varied jurisprudential philosophies, what's clear to me is that we are all dedicated to upholding the court's integrity and independence. We each take to heart our commitment to serve the court's ideals of following the rule of law and providing our litigants with due process and justice. I look forward, as chief, to working together with all of you to ensure our circuit's continued distinguished legacy. Of course, it's not just the judges who are dedicated to the fair administration of justice in our circuit. I want to voice my appreciation to our staff, Molly Dreyer, our clerk of court, Sue Song, our circuit executive, Libby Smith, our former circuit executive, and Kathy Catterson, our previous court clerk and circuit executive, for their excellent leadership. Your individual and collective hard work has left and will leave an indelibly positive impression on our circuit's administration and culture. Thank you. And I would be remiss if I didn't thank the law clerks, staff attorneys, paralegals, librarians, docketing clerks, and administrative staff across the circuit. Your competence and dedication to excellence in your work is what makes our courts run so effectively and what makes our work possible. My law clerks and many of my former law clerks are here today. And if I could ask you to please stand.
Thank you.
You have impressed me with your sharp and discerning minds and your enthusiasm to get it right. It's been a true pleasure working together, and I'm so very proud of all of you. I must acknowledge Kristen Paris, my judicial assistant. Of course, she's sitting in the last row. You keep me organized and on track. You provide perspective, a sense of humor, and much relied upon competence in all things, including in putting together this truly fantastic event in the midst of all your other responsibilities. I am very fortunate and extremely grateful to work with you every day. Thank you, Kristen. Finally, to my friends from every stage and phase of my life and my family, some of whom have traveled a great distance to be here, I am overwhelmed by your show of support. Your presence today and throughout my life has meant so much to me on so many levels. It is my family and these friendships that nourish and sustain me. You have brought and continue to bring me so much joy. Please know how grateful I am to have you in my life. I simply would not be here without you. In concluding my remarks, I want to take a moment to acknowledge and celebrate the fact that someone from my background has the opportunity and privilege to serve in this capacity. Had my parents been here today, this occasion would have confirmed to them once again their faith in the ideals of our country as a place of fairness and opportunity. It would have confirmed to them the enduring strength of their love and optimism. My parents' lives were not easy, yet in spite of their many hardships, they always somehow remained positive, resilient, and hopeful. And I can't even begin to imagine how happy and proud they both would be, but especially my father, that the saying that is known to many in the Latino culture, but certainly repeated in our household, is on my gavel today. Because aquí en este país el sol sí sale para todos. In these United States, this sun does shine for everyone. Both my parents believed that opportunities would follow from hard work and perseverance, and their values are a part of me. I once heard Justice Sandra Day O'Connor say that the greatest privilege one can be given is to be asked to be a judge of your peers. Being a judge has been the greatest privilege and greatest honor of my life. I recognize that I assumed the position of chief by virtue of fortunate timing. But it is a responsibility that I welcome with profound respect. As the circuit's next chief, I will do my utmost to put into practice the values instilled in me: resilience, commitment to hard work, and a realistic optimism in meeting the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead. And my parents would tell us, if we ran into trouble, or even sometimes in times of success, their words of encouragement was, adelante. You heard Casey say it here today. I think they didn't want us to dwell too much on any success, but they also didn't want us to dwell too much on any difficulty. They cherished the past, but they always looked forward to the future. As the circuit's next chief, I will do my utmost to put into practice all of these values that they have instilled in me. Resilience, commitment to hard work, and a realistic optimism in meeting the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead. I will advocate for the circuit and for the courts within the circuit, consistent with the circuit's ideals and the legacy of Chief Judge Thomas and our previous Chief Circuit judges. I will work together with you to ensure the fair and effective administration of justice for everyone, recognizing and protecting the dignity of every person. The road ahead is daunting and exciting. Thank you, and adelante.
Be immediately a reception on the patio of the courthouse and the immediate outside. For those of you who are from outside of Arizona, if you go outside and enjoy a reception there, you'll understand why we agree to live here in July. It's for receptions in November. And Chief Judge Thomas and Chief Judge Murguia invite you to join them there. And with that, I do declare closed this special session of the United States Court of Appeals for the Ninth Circuit. Thank you for your attendance.